In many countries, obesity is a major and growing public health problem. Worldwide rates have tripled since 1975, and roughly 40% of the adult population today is either obese or overweight. This has sparked an urgent search for policy tools to combat obesity, and one increasingly popular option is front-of-package labels. These are visual warnings placed prominently on the front of packaged food items to signal that a product is considered unhealthy. Since 2016, such labels have become mandatory, or are in the process of being implemented, in over 30 countries. But are labels effective? Proponents argue they are an innocuous tool to improve consumer welfare, as they merely provide information. Opponents counter that labels are unlikely to shape consumers' decisions and further impose an unnecessary burden on firms. In fact, while much of the policy discussion on food labels focuses on consumers' responses, understanding the supply-side effects is crucial. If, for example, firms respond to mandatory labels by reformulating products or changing prices, they may undo or amplify any positive effects for consumers. This paper explores these issues and analyzes the first mandatory nationwide front-of-package labeling regulation to be implemented, the Chilean Food Act of 2016. This established threshold values for sugar, calories, sodium, and saturated fat concentration, and required that suppliers place a warning label on the front of their product for each threshold surpassed. This means a single product could have anywhere from 0 to 4 labels. The authors estimate the causal effect of the act on both consumers and firms using scanner-level data provided by Walmart. Walmart is the largest food retailer in Chile, accounting for more than 40% of supermarket sales, and these data cover all transactions at Walmart stores countrywide between May 2015 and March 2018. These data are supplemented with digitized nutrition facts tables for over 6,000 products and survey data on consumer beliefs. To start, how did labels affect consumers' nutritional intake? Here, we see the total amount of sugar and calories purchased for every dollar spent in a given 8-week period. These lines indicate when labels first appeared in some supermarkets, and these lines show when they became mandatory for every product in every store. The dashed lines calculate sugar and calorie totals after fixing products' nutritional content at their pre-Food Act levels, while the solid lines use actual nutritional content. Immediately after the policy was phased in, sugar and calorie intake declined by 7 to 9%. This reflects both that consumers shifted to buying a different and healthier bundle of products, and that the nutritional content of individual products was healthier post-Food Act. The authors disentangle the demand and supply responses driving these effects by focusing on the market for breakfast cereal. First, consider the demand side. The fact that consumers shifted to a healthier bundle of products suggests they either switched from unhealthy to healthy product categories, or substituted from unhealthy to healthy products within categories. There is little evidence for the former, but within category, we do see a substantial and persistent shift from labeled to unlabeled products. Post-Food Act, the quantity of labeled products sold relative to unlabeled ones fell by an average of 26.4%. Notably, consumer beliefs play an important role. A decomposition shows this decline is driven by products that consumers mistakenly believe to be low in calories. In other words, if consumers already believe a product to be unhealthy, adding a label has no significant effect. But when labels correct a mistaken belief, they have large effects on consumer behavior. Turning to the supply side, recall that part of this decline in sugar and calorie intake appeared to be driven by changes in products' nutritional content. And, indeed, suppliers responded to the Food Act by reformulating their products to avoid receiving a label. This figure compares the distribution of calorie concentration for breakfast cereals pre- and post-Food Act. Sugar and calorie concentrations declined by 11.5% and 2.8% on average, and many firms modified their nutritional content just enough to squeeze below the regulatory threshold. And because it is costly for suppliers to reformulate products, prices for consumers also went up. The regulation increased the prices of unlabeled products relative to labeled ones by 5.5%. So, to summarize, the Food Act shifted consumer behavior, but also induced supply-side responses, some of which were beneficial to consumers, others of which were not. To assess the overall impact, the authors estimate a model of demand and supply in the market for food. Their results show that the Food Act led to overall gains in consumer welfare, and supply-side responses amplified these gains. The benefit to consumers of product reformulations outweighed the cost of higher prices. Thus, front-of-package labels can be an effective way to improve diet and combat obesity. How do they compare to other policy tools? In particular, sugar taxes, which levy a per-ounce tax on any product with added sugar, are one of the most widely used alternative policies. The paper shows that while taxes and labels can generate similar gains in consumer welfare, taxes can be regressive if they disproportionately increase the price of unhealthy products that are more widely consumed by poorer households. As such, labels may be preferable from a distributional point of view. To read more on this topic, you can check out the paper's references to other related work. These include other papers on the Chilean Food Act, those studying policies to improve nutrition, and finally, research on consumers' choices in settings with imperfect information.